All right, so today's facilitators, I'm Julie Bancroft, Chief Public Affairs Officer with PCADV. Some of you may have been used to working with Lindsay Scott, our former Senior Government Relations Specialist, and she left PCADV at the end of March to pursue another opportunity, so I'll be your contact until we have a new staff person on board. Please feel free to reach out to me. Hi everyone, this is Donna Greco. I'm the Policy Director at PCAR and really glad that you could make time to join us today to talk about our annual Advocacy Day, which is coming up on May 7th, and we're very excited about it. Before we dive into the content, we wanted to get a sense from you if you have participated in Advocacy Day before. You can go ahead and use the chat to respond. If you have participated before, if you want to share a strength or a highlight that you took away from that experience, or if there are ways you think we should be improving upon Advocacy Day, we'd love to hear about that as well. So if you want to just go ahead and use the chat to share your responses to these questions, we'd be very grateful. Great. So we're hearing from Kelsey that this will be your first year participating, and that's wonderful. We will be eager to hear what you think. Yep. And Nicole, this will be your first year as well. Wonderful. Okay. So it sounds like we have some new advocates joining us, and we're very excited about that. If questions come up for you throughout today's webinar, things that are on your mind, concerns, questions, please feel free to use the chat. We will also have time at the end of the webinar for some question and answer as well. But our goal is really to provide as much information today and leading up to the event so that whether you're new or you've been to Advocacy Day every year, that you feel well prepared to have a successful day at the Capitol. Hi, Tom. Welcome to the webinar. Before we start talking about our legislative priorities, we wanted just to remind you all that your voices are the most compelling voices to legislators and to staff in that building, because you are coming from the local districts, you're coming from local communities. You are also coming from local experiences in serving sexual and domestic violence victims and survivors, the communities that you work with. And so you already have expertise to share in that building that's really unduplicated. And so if you are feeling at all intimidated, or if this is new, or you're, you know, for some reason feeling like maybe nervous about being there and meeting with legislators, we just really wanted to remind you that you really have tremendous expertise, and you already have everything you need to have a successful meeting with a legislator on Advocacy Day and beyond. So next, we're sharing some maps of the state capitol with you. For those of you who are doing this for your first time, the capitol can be a bit intimidating. It's a very large complex. The wayfinding signage is not great, but don't let that get you down. For those of us that spend a lot of time at the Capitol, we still frequently need to ask for help to find office locations, and I always say I'm certain I've walked in front of the same folks three or four times trying to find where I'm going. So don't feel bad if you're having trouble finding a location. And what you see here is the main floor of the Capitol. The main rotunda is where we'll be having our press event, and that's also where you will enter the Capitol. You will want to plan to allow time for security. You will have to go through security to enter the Capitol building, so just factor that into timing for the morning. But you'll see that when you enter the main entrance, there's an info desk immediately on your right. That's very helpful. They can provide you with maps of the Capitol and direct you if you're having any trouble finding your location. We are also going to have, in the main rotunda, both PCAR and PCADV will have information tables set up. So we'll have staff there, as well as a home-based room where everyone will check in on Advocacy Day. So both of those locations can be helpful, and staff will be available at both locations should you need any assistance. You'll also see a map of the East Wing atrium. And again, this is just kind of to try to get you acquainted. And then this is the lower level of the main Capitol and East Wing. So what you'll see here is the East Wing Rotunda and also the wheelchair accessible entrance. You'll also see the restaurant. So there are some, if you could either pack your lunch on the day of, there's some seating in the East Wing. And there is a restaurant as well if you want to grab lunch in between your meetings. And we will be convening in where you see the red arrow, room number 49E. So when you check in on May 7th, you'll go through security and then you'll want to proceed to the East Wing, room 49E, and we will have staff there to get you set up with all the information that you need for the day to have a successful visit. And the other thing to note is in terms of parking, and we'll make sure that you have additional information about parking and dining, but parking is available outside of the Capitol on street parking. It's metered. And there are also several parking garages throughout the city very close to the Capitol. If you do use the metered parking, there are machines you can pay with cash or credit card, and it's best to enter your phone number so that you can get text messages so that you can extend your parking directly from your phone so that you don't get a ticket. They are pretty ruthless about ticketing. All right, so just to give you a sense of what will happen on the day of May 7th, 9 to 11 a.m. is we will have staff available to assist you. So as I mentioned, packet pickup will be in 49 East Wing, and that has been confirmed, so please plan to meet us there. And we'll have staff there, and we will have staff from 9 to 11 in that room. So throughout the day, if you have questions, if you have feedback to share from your visits, please feel free to come back, share that information with PCAR and PCADV staff. Also, if you need additional materials for your meeting, we'll have those there as well. Like I said, we'll have tables, information tables in the main rotunda. Those will be on display from 9 to noon. And at 11:30 is when we will have the press event in the main rotunda. So as you schedule your visits, we'd ask if you can be available for the press event. And then we'll wrap that up by noon. And you can continue to have legislative visits in the afternoon. Feel free to schedule those, but we just want to make sure that everyone's aware that the morning hours are when staff will be available to assist you. So the building, as Julie said, is quite large, and it's also beautiful. If this is your first time in the building, I hope you do get a chance to just sort of pause and look around and absorb the beautiful artwork. It is stunning. It is a national treasure. And what you see here are tiles that are very hard on your feet. So we really encourage you to wear comfortable shoes, bring what you need to be comfortable that day. And again, if you need any assistance, if you get lost, if you need to check in, we will have staff available to you to help support you. And there are wonderful Capitol staff as well that know the ins and outs of that building and can also be a great resource to you. So as Julie mentioned, we will have our press event at 11:30 in the main rotunda, and we are still working on confirming some of our speakers, but we know that both directors of our coalition, Susan and Karen, will kick us off and will also serve to introduce the other speakers. We've been able to confirm on PCAR's side, Representative Joanna McClinton from Philadelphia will be joining us to talk about sexual extortion. We just heard yesterday that Representative Ted Nesbitt will also be joining us. They partnered together in a bipartisan fashion to craft this bill, and we're very grateful for both of them and their leadership. We have also reached out to the governor's office. We're hoping that someone from the governor's office, if not the governor himself, will speak about the It's On Us campus sexual and domestic violence legislative package. And we are still waiting to confirm some of our other speakers, and as soon as we have that information, we'll get it out to you. So moving into our policy priorities for Advocacy Day. For PCADV, we're going to focus generically on our 2019-2020 policy agenda. Having come off of the last session with the success of HB 2060, domestic violence homicide prevention being signed into law, which was just implemented yesterday, We don't have a signature piece of legislation this session, and we're doing a little bit more defense. Unfortunately, there's a lot that we are paying attention to. So this what you see on your screen are our key priority areas. So increased funding for domestic violence programs and supportive services, domestic and teen dating violence prevention, access to safe and affordable housing, trauma-informed services for survivors and their children, economic justice and financial self-sufficiency, enhancing services for victims and survivors of marginalized groups, and access to the justice system. So we're looking at policies that fall into these categories. And we can look at some of the specific ones that we're tracking now. And while we'll talk about these, what I would note is legislation seems to be moving at a very rapid pace right now. These priorities may change by the time that we actually have Advocacy Day, but these are some of the things that we are paying attention to. And we'll make sure that you have a current list when you join us on the 7th. Like I said, some of this may change in that short time frame. But one of the first pieces we're looking at is what's called the Buyer Beware Act. We don't love the name, but it's HB 12, sponsored by Representative Seth Grove. And it's a bill that is a human trafficking bill and protects. So it's something we support, and I'm actually just, this one I haven't looked at for a while, so I'm blanking here. Yes,
this is one that PCAR also supports, and this really aims to combat the demand side of sex trafficking by increasing penalties and fines for traffickers and for consumers of sex trafficking. So it's definitely one that both coalitions are prioritizing and supporting. We know that really to end this crime, we need to really address the demand side that really creates victims of sex trafficking.
Thank you for
sure.
That, Donna. Next one is General Assistance Fund. You may have heard that there's been a bill introduced to eliminate the General Assistance Fund. And this is a small benefit, about $200, that helps victims of domestic violence and others from marginalized groups with basic necessities. So while it's a small benefit, it's a really important benefit. This bill is moving. It's a priority of the GOP. We expect that it will continue to move. Unfortunately, there are a lot of advocacy groups trying to prevent this from being enacted. So this is definitely one where the status may have changed by the time that you're with us in May, but one that we definitely want to be speaking to. The next two bills that you see here deal with strangulation, HB 249 and Senate Bill 275. And both of these bills, what they do is they add strangulation in the list of crimes of violence. Interesting note about this, a nearly identical bill was also introduced by a freshman representative, and that bill surprisingly ran early this week, and we expect that one to now move, and that may actually move before Advocacy Day actually occurs. So that may go all the way through to a final vote by the time that we meet. So we will absolutely update you on the status of this kind of package of strangulation bills. The next one is the waiver of fees for victims of domestic violence. This is sponsored by Representative Karen Boback. It's HB 489. And this is simply a bill that prevents victims from having to pay fees for duplicate documents such as driver's license, birth certificates, things like that. So this is one that we support. We obviously don't want to have additional barriers to accessing safety. The next one is protection from forced child marriage. So again, both Senate and House bills for this. And this is a bill these are bills that would prevent individuals under the age of 18 from being able to obtain a marriage license. And the last one that you see here is HB 485, again, being carried by Representative Boback. And this is intended to help victims and survivors of domestic violence avoid harassment through abusers using caller ID spoofing to harass them and stalk them.
Okay, so PCAR has a set of 6 legislative priorities. In addition to these 6, we are tracking and watching many of the other bills that Julie mentioned, including the trafficking legislation. We also support Marcy's Law and Karen's Law and a number of bills that would strengthen testimony and the Rape Shield Law in the criminal justice realm as well. But these are the six priorities that our Public Policy Committee identified for this legislative session, and I'm just going to walk through each one. Our first is to criminalize acts of sexual extortion. This is a carryover from last session. We saw a lot of progress in the Senate last session. It actually unanimously passed that chamber, but we really ran out of time in the House. It wasn't for lack of support. It was lack of time at the end of session. So we're back at it again, jiggity jig, as we typically are with legislative work. So we have a bill in the Senate sponsored by Senators Schwenk and Kim Ward. Again, we have bipartisan support for this bill in both chambers. The bill was unanimously passed out of the Senate Judiciary Committee the week of March 25th, and we are hoping that Senator Cormann, the floor leader of the Senate, will schedule the bill for consideration on the floor of that chamber before it moves over to the House. In the House, we have a bill that we are finalizing. We have Representatives Nesbitt and McClinton signed on to that, and it will be a very similar bill, but not identical. And again, this would really create a new crime in Pennsylvania when someone abuses their power or authority in order to coerce sexual acts, images, or videos from a victim. They may have power by way of their formal position in the community or in their professional role, or they may have power over another person because they have information or an image already, and then they use that to threaten harm and to demand additional sexually explicit acts or images from the victim. It is unfortunately not currently illegal to do that in Pennsylvania. It really falls through the cracks of our extortion law as well as other sex crimes. And what happens is victims don't know that they're a victim of a crime. If they do know and they report it, the charges really are diluted. Prosecutors really are not able to prosecute this crime effectively. They have to kind of piece together other statutes and other laws in order to hold offenders accountable for the harm that they've created. So we do see a lot of support for this. We've not heard any opposition to it. It seems like a very straightforward bill that would really help many Pennsylvanians. The next priority that PCAR has been working on is to create some supports for victims of rape and incest when they go to petition to terminate the parental rights of the rapist. There was a law that was passed in 2015 that prohibits courts from awarding any type of custody or visitation to a convicted rapist. However, that individual is still legally considered a parent, even if the child was conceived and born out of the violent act of rape or incest. So we have had victims and survivors come forward who, for very good reason, would like to cut those legal ties, would like that name erased from their children's lives, and when they go to petition the courts to do just that, the courts interpret existing law to require that the victim have another adoptive parent ready to step in the shoes of the rapist. And this is rooted in a very antiquated notion that a two-parent family is always best for a child, and PCAR does not argue against that, and that's really not something we're even taking a position on. What we're concerned about is that we're talking about a victim and a child that never was a two-parent family to begin with. We're talking about a violent crime, a child born out of that, a parent who is doing just fine raising that child and would like to protect that child from any harm. So we do have support in both chambers. We have two potential sponsors, and we are just working out some language, and we are very excited to move this forward so that victims do not have to have an adoptive parent to take the place of the person who harmed them. We have also seen progress in strengthening sexual assault evidence collection and testing. Senator Langerholt's bill, which was Senate Bill 399, also unanimously passed out of the Senate Judiciary Committee the week of March 25th. This would establish some consistencies around the state related to evidence collection and testing. One of the provisions would clarify how a new phone line should work. Last session, a new phone line was established for hospitals to call when rape kits are not being picked up within 72 hours. So this bill would clarify that that line should be staffed by a live person and should result in a swift call to law enforcement with jurisdiction. Those rape kits should be picked up swiftly and gotten to the lab per Act 27. Senate Bill 399 would also establish county-level consistencies in addressing unknown jurisdiction. So there are many reasons why a victim may not be able to pinpoint precisely where the crime occurred. It could be that they're new to the area and they don't know street names and, you know, buildings and sort of landmarks in a community. It may be nighttime, they may be in a moving vehicle, they may be incapacitated due to drugs or alcohol or due to the violent nature of the crime. And so what happens is if they come to the hospital for the forensic rape exam and they're not able to say exactly where the crime occurred, those kits are considered unknown jurisdiction. And then in many counties, law enforcement are not coming to pick them up because no one knows who's responsible for those kits. And so throughout the state, we have, I think it's around 60 to 70 kits that are considered unknown jurisdiction, and this is just in the past 6 months, and those kits are being held at hospitals, which puts us out of compliance with Act 27, but more importantly, it does a disservice to victims of sexual violence who've already gone through a traumatic event, have reported to the hospital, have gone through a very long and invasive exam, and think that their kits are actually being moved to the crime labs, and they're not. They're stuck at hospitals. So we are grateful to Senator Langerholt and his office for addressing this issue by requiring either the state police to pick up these kits or for counties to figure out another solution. This bill would also establish some consistencies in anonymous kit collection and testing. In some counties in Pennsylvania, this is an option to victims who may not want their names attached to evidence for safety reasons, but it's not available to all victims in all counties. So it's really our position that it should not matter where you are assaulted and your options should not depend on your zip code or your county. We want to see some consistencies throughout the state for all victims of sexual violence. The bill would also ensure that victims have access to sexual assault counselors through the Rape Crisis Center network and also extend the preservation of evidence for the full duration of statute of limitations or 20 years, whichever is less. And it also prohibits victims from being charged for forensic rape exams. And legally, technically, they are not to be charged, but there is still human error, and we still hear every year of cases, we'll hear the victims receiving a bill for a forensic rape exam, which is egregious and needs to be prevented. As Julie mentioned, PCAR also supports the bill that would establish 18 as the minimum age of marriage without exception, and the bill would address a couple loopholes in Pennsylvania that still allow children as young as 16 or 17 years old to be married with parental consent. There's also a second loophole that allows a judge and or a guardian or parent to allow a child to marry if it is in their best interest without any minimum age. We are concerned that child marriage is often linked to issues of child sexual abuse. You know, a child may be running away from the home due to family violence, sexual abuse in the home, only to then enter into a marriage where there are stark power imbalances and where they go on to experience ongoing marital sexual violence, physical violence, a lot of poverty, interrupted education, isolation. We also see drug and alcohol dependency, as well as unplanned pregnancies and most of these marriages end up in divorce and really undermine the economic and physical, emotional, and social well-being of girls and women. So we support this bill without exception, and we have heard that it is likely to move in the House in May.
In May, we will be in the heart of budget season, so this is also a great time and an opportunity to use your meetings to also talk about the funding needs for delivery of services to victims and survivors of domestic and sexual violence. PCADV and PCAR have been working jointly on their budget advocacy, and we started with trying to advocate for a 10% increase in the governor's budget. So early on in the process, both Susan Higginbotham and Karen Baker met with the governor's budget office to make the ask. Unfortunately, we did not see that increase included in the governor's budget. We actually have not seen a significant increase for either line item since the Corbett administration. And for the last few budget cycles, we've been flat funded. So we do feel that this ask is warranted. So, and you'll see some feedback that we've received is instead of asking for 10%, and you might want to talk about this if you're comfortable talking about funding needs in your meetings, but talking about those as numbers. So for PCADV, a $1.73 million increase, and for PCAR, a $990,000 increase, because putting it in that perspective in the grand scheme of things is not a significant ask, but has significant impact for serving the needs of Pennsylvania's communities. So some of the talking points here on why we're making the ask is the complexity of needs in the communities and the lack of other service providers or cuts to other service provider funding and the strain that those things have placed on the local programs and centers. So you're a really powerful voice in budget advocacy because your legislators want to hear specifically from you about the local impact. What impact does a lack of increased funding have on your program, on delivering services? What are the specific needs in your community? That voice and that ask is so much more powerful from a constituent than it is from us. We can make the case, but they want to hear what the impact is at the community level. Also, PCAR hotline and prevention demand has increased from the last fiscal year, so it's another important talking point if you're advocating for PCAR's priorities. And another thing that we've been talking a lot about with legislators through our budget advocacy is just the need to be able to pay a living wage in the programs and hopefully have less turnover. We know that these are high burnout positions and we want to be able to attract talent and the best talent to be able to serve the needs of victims and survivors. So what we continue to advocate together. We've been meeting with appropriations staff and we've shifted our focus now from the governor's budget to the General Assembly's budget, and we're hopeful that we can successfully see an increase in the legislative budget. One of the things that you can do if you have a strong relationship with your senator, you can ask your senator to include domestic violence and sexual assault services in their priority letters that they send to appropriations and leadership. So if you do have those relationships and are comfortable making that ask, please do. We continue to hear that budget will actually happen in June, and we're hopeful that that is the case. So as Julie mentioned, the flow of the day really offers some flexibility for you to schedule meetings, and those are very important. As Julie mentioned, legislators really, really do listen to their constituents and to the local stories, the local struggles, as well as the local successes that you all are bringing into your conversations that day. So what you can do now is go ahead and make appointments and get on the calendar of your legislators and or their staff. If you do not get a meeting directly with your legislator, that is okay. Sometimes the staff are just as important as meeting directly with the legislator. Oftentimes staff are the subject matter experts, or they are tasked with really researching an issue or, you know,
engaging in constituent relations, and so meeting with staff is just a critical part of advocacy. They then carry your message forward to the legislator and really prioritize it on your behalf. So you may get 15 minutes, you may get 30 minutes, you may get more than that. And so go ahead and do make those calls to get on the calendar of your legislators now. It is not too early to make those appointments. And you're going to want to research your legislators so that you're going into that meeting really knowing your audience and knowing where they stand. Do they have a position of leadership? What committees are they on? Particularly if they're on committees like Judiciary, Health and Human Services, Education, Children and Youth, Aging, Urban Affairs. Those are all committees that we work with, and certainly appropriations, given that this is budget season. You're going to want to flag that they serve on those committees because they are influential in voting and in bringing issues to the chairs of those committees for prioritization. You'll also want to see what their history is with your center. You may already know that. Perhaps your executive director or your board or other staff may have personal connections with legislators, or they remember a time when the legislator came to an event. All of those things matter, those human connections, being able to thank them for their support, being able to remind them that they came to an event and it really mattered to your agency, it mattered to survivors, it mattered to your community. So really making sure you leverage those contacts. Perhaps you went to the same college, perhaps you went to the same high school, maybe kids are, you know, mingling on the same teams. Anything that you can find out and reference during that meeting will be meaningful because people are just people, whether they're a legislator or a staffer, and they like to connect on that human level. You will also want to take a look at the legislator's website, look at news articles, look at their social networking. What was their political platform if they were newly elected? What did they really run on, and how can you connect that issue to the issues of sexual and domestic violence? If you do not have time to do this exhaustive research, that is okay. Julie and I may already know a lot about the legislator that you're meeting with. We would also be glad to do some of that research for you just to help support you in going into that meeting feeling like you're grounded in knowing your audience. You'll also want to familiarize yourself with the materials that we will be sending you in advance. We'll be sending you our policy priorities. We'll be sending you talking points and budget advocacy resources. So make sure you take a look at those, but then always know that you should and can infuse those messages with local impact stories and talk about what you know and talk about what you see and how many survivors you've served and how many prevention programs you've delivered and successes in that and also challenges in that. So following up to the tips that Donna shared, you want to make sure you do the preparation that she talked about so that you can have a successful meeting. And when you're in the actual meeting, there are some things you can do to make sure that that occurs. And of course, you want to introduce yourself, your program or center, and the district. You also want to thank the legislator or the staffer for their time. As Donna mentioned, the staffer can be just as important as the legislator, so please be gracious if you do meet with a staffer. And if you can make that connection, any type of personal connection, involvement in the district, maybe you serve on the same community board as a staff member or the legislator themselves, make those connections. You want to talk about your organization, who you serve, your impact in the community. Again, that's what's most important to them, what's happening in the district. And one of the things you can do is you want to make an ask. So the way that you can make that most comfortable is look at the materials in advance. Find the topics and the priorities that resonate most with you and with your program or center, and focus on a few of them. You're going to have a limited amount of time. And connect those priorities to why you're there and why the work matters and why these issues matter and should matter to the legislators as well. And then you'll make your ask. And again, that's why kind of honing in on a few
priority areas that you're most comfortable with, or you have a lot of supportive examples to support why the ask is so important, that's going to be helpful. And then, of course, you want to end with thanking them again for their time, making sure that you're clear on any follow-up. You may need to send additional information, maybe data, maybe information about a specific initiative at your program or center. And it's always best then to, if you have promised any follow-up, to do that as quickly as possible, but also to reach out and thank them for their time. This also helps you build a continuing relationship with them. You certainly want to have those relationships and nurture them in the event that something that is really helpful to victims and survivors might come up legislatively, and then you can reach back out. Or on the other side of that, something that would be really harmful. You want to know that you can reach out, remind them that you've had these meetings and have established this relationship so that you can get their attention. So do follow up if you can find the time, and it can be really brief, and just thank them and remind them what you were there for and continue that relationship however you can. So we've shared a sample script here, and I think we've covered a lot of this already. As Julie mentioned, you may get some questions during the meeting, and it's okay if you don't have all of the answers right away. That happens to us all the time. And just, you know, thank them for their question. Let them know you're going to research it and get back to them with more information in the future. And I think at the heart of this script is really, again, talking about what you know, the work that you do, why you do the work that you do, connecting on that human level, sharing a compelling story about a constituent or about a successful prevention program. I know I mentioned earlier one of PCAR's top priorities is the termination of parental rights in cases of rape and incest. And you can kind of get tongue-tied. I get tongue-tied talking about that issue. And who are we talking about? We're not talking about, you know, the victim parent, we're talking about the offender parent and adoptive parents. And I think what's most compelling when we go and lobby and advocate on this issue is to share the story of the victim that actually came forward and reached out to PCAR. And she had survived years and years of sexual abuse by her stepfather, had two children from those years of abuse. And when her youngest child turned the age that she was when she was first assaulted by her stepfather was when she finally came forward and reported him. And we see that so often with victims of sexual violence, with their children, when their children turn the same age they were, really this desire to protect and this desire to do something and to report. And so she did, and the offender is incarcerated for a very long time and will never have visitation or custody, but still is named the legal father of her two children that she has been parenting beautifully. These children are thriving, and she would like to further protect them from harm. And so when we share her story and when her attorney comes with us to talk about how they've been advocating directly with this courageous woman, you just see legislators' faces change. You see them lean forward. You see staff, you know, really lean forward and really get emotionally invested in what we're trying to do with this bill. So I think, you know, pairing the talking points that we'll be sending your way with those human impact stories will be very powerful, and I'm sure you have many of them. So we have about 15 minutes. We wanted to leave time for questions that you may have. You can go ahead and use the chat to pose questions about any of the legislation we covered, the logistics of the day, the building, or if you have tips that you would want to share with each other, or anything else that may be on your mind. You can go ahead and use the chat. A couple people typing. Okay, thank you, Tom. We will be providing updates. As Julie mentioned, things are really moving during Crime Victims Awareness Week. So we will have updates and we will have materials out to you in advance of Advocacy Day for sure. If there are no other questions, we just want to thank you for your time. We know that you advocate in so many different ways in your community, and we thank you for bringing those wonderful advocacy skills into the policy realm. Please let us know if questions come up between now and then and how we can support you.
And if you have a few moments, we would invite you to click on the evaluation link in the evaluation box and just give us some feedback on how the webinar was today. Thank you so much for your time.